Good afternoon to you. Delighted to be back in Estonia and in Tallinn at this academy. I was last here in 2016 in this very room giving a lecture about social entrepreneurship. And that was very interesting, a very interesting response from the audience as well. So my name is Tony Woodcock, and I now live in Valencia, Spain, where it's about 26 degrees at the moment, beautifully sunny, and in sharp contrast to being here, but it's still interesting to...
It won't snow here, actually.
Really? Okay, it won't snow in Valencia, I can absolutely promise you that. I'll tell you a little bit about my background in a moment, but one thing you should know is that I lived and worked in America for 20 years. And I ran the New England Conservatory of Music in Boston for about 10 years. And before that, I was running symphony orchestras. So my background is very much in the performing arts with the Minnesota Orchestra, and in England with the Royal Liverpool Philharmonic Orchestra, and in higher education as well. So it's a very, very complimentary look at our entire industry of music, learning, and performance as well. Because I lived and worked in America, I'm used to people behaving in a particular way. And when I'm teaching American students, see, the way that you're seated at the moment, it's very... He won't pick on me, will he? He will be nice. I'm terribly nice. But American students are really exciting to teach because they give you a lot of energy. They ask impossible questions, and they don't let you finish a sentence before they're pushing you and pouncing on you. And I want you today to pretend to be American. Can you do that for me? Yes, you can. You can be authentic, and you can still be Estonian, but I want to feel that energy as well. So I'm going to give you an American exercise to do. And you'll be thinking, oh, ugh. Because you behave, I can see, you behave like an English audience. An English audience will always sit at the back, as far away from you as they possibly can, and they'll put their head down, hoping that you won't see them. So I see the same little bit of behavior here as well. So this is the exercise. It's just a fun exercise so that I can get to know you a bit better, and you can get to know one another better, because I imagine that you don't know everyone around you at the moment. So this is the exercise. I want you all to stand up in just a second. Listen to the assignment to begin with. I'd like you all to stand up and line up here in order of the date of your birth. Not the year, not the year. So I'll say it again. Not the year, but the month and the date, okay? So month and date in order along here, but you're not allowed to speak. Okay? You're not allowed to speak or whisper or write anything down. You have to work it out. So I want January at the bottom and December at the top. So month and day of the month. No years, okay? Over to you. No whispering. So month and day of the month. You've got to get the day of the month right as well. So you have to all be in sequence at the end of this. Thank you. Okay, you're in sequence now. That's writing. Broken rules there. So we're all in sequence. We've got a little bottleneck here. Can you get in the right sequence? Because what needs to happen now is we should go straight up the line here, and you should all be perfectly in sequence. So you good? Okay. Let's see how you've done. Let's start in January.
August 26th.
How did we get? August needs to be back there somewhere. Get it to sequence.
10th of July.
June should be here. Change places. Okay. Let's start with June again. Where was June? What date are you in June?
6.
What were you? May. So June 6th.
July 10th.
July 8th.
Yeah. What were you in the corner there? Just here? No, we're missing somebody just there. What date were you? No, you. What date were you? What date were you?
Me.
This young lady here. Which date were you?
August.
August. So you found, okay. So we're still with June, are we?
I'm July.
Okay, July? July?
July
what?
10th.
July 29th.
Okay.
36th.
Yeah. August? What are you?
26th of August.
26th of August. Okay. You'll get the hang of it. What are you?
26th of August.
26th? September. Yeah.
3rd of
September. Uh-huh.
Okay. 23rd of September.
5th of October. And 15th of November.
Of
15th November.
15th November. Your birthday's coming up. Very good. Okay, big round of applause for you all. You know, take your seats again. Well, my conclusion is you're all incredibly talented, and you were able to do that assignment, apart from the young lady who was confused by the month of August, extremely well. So, the title of today's talk, and I mean, I'll be asking you a lot of questions during this as well, so it's not just me talking, I want to hear from you, yes?
Do you want us to interrupt?
You can interrupt, you can disagree, you can do whatever you'd like.
Okay.
But let me say this bit first, all right?
But you know, American is coming out.
Yes? Well, that's good. So this is the title. And yesterday I did an interview for somebody on the radio here. Is it part of the university, I think? And her first question to me was a really interesting one, which I thought I'd share with you. And the question that she asked was, what qualifies you to ask this question? Pretty good. So this is how I answered. I spent my entire career in classical music, jazz, and other types of music. And that goes back, dare I say it, a very, very long time. So I started with performing arts organizations, symphony orchestras, and then I moved into higher education later on. And in the last 3 years or so, living back in Europe, I created a consultancy to work in higher education and the performing arts. And that has allowed me to visit a lot of conservatoires around Europe, and also a lot of music schools and conservatoires in the United States as well. Recently, I was working with six organizations in Europe, the Association of European Conservatoires, the Royal Conservatoire at The Hague, the Sibelius Academy, the Royal Academy at Aarhus, the Guildhall School of Music and Drama, and the Oslo Academy. And that was to do with a special project to do with musical entrepreneurship. And I worked on that for about at least a year with all of those people. In America, I've worked with Yale, Thornton School at University of Southern California, Rice University, Manhattan School, Eastman School, a whole variety. So I've seen a real cross-section of what is happening in the music world, in our industry. And I'm concerned about its future. I'm concerned because I see our importance for this great art form that we all love and know and cherish, and we really want to be central to everyone's being and experience of the world. I see that diminishing. I see it going away and being on the sidelines somewhere. I see our relevance being questioned because fewer and fewer people know anything about classical music. And I see our legitimacy, that is, all those things that make up the strongest argument, the strongest ownership of everything that we're doing, also starting to diminish, which means that many people question, well, why should we be investing in these things for the future? Why are they important when they touch so few lives and appear to do so little good? And what I've seen with performing organizations and with higher education is a desire, a very strong desire, not to change. A desire for it to be everybody else's problem but theirs. A desire for people to come over and see it from their point of view rather than walking over and seeing it from the rest of the world's point of view, from the contemporary world's point of view. So my question is, what needs to change in that mix, in those arguments and with those perceptions? So that's where I'm coming from, and that's why I'm asking you this question. So you should see me as a sort of militant priest who still occasionally likes to smell the incense, because it's still very deeply in my soul, if that makes sense. And you might be thinking, well, he's going to be telling us about, you know, the phrase dumbing down? Yeah, dumbing down, which is, you know, bring everything to the lowest possible common denominator, the lowest way of experiencing anything, make it as popular as you possibly can. I'm not, actually, although there's a great deal to be learned from the popular world, huge amount that classical music could learn from the popular world. What I want is to innovate up. I want to take us all up into the stratosphere of some of the new thinking that is happening in higher education and in technology in particular. So this is what you should expect. I think I've done the introduction and my background. But these are some of the things that we'll be touching upon. And I think it's perhaps the last one is the most important, which is that so many students, what, 650 students here, what are their expectations when they graduate? Because your prime expectation, I would suggest, is how am I going to be employed? Where am I going to be employed? How much will I be paid? What type of life am I going to be having? So that's what we're going to be covering. Does that make sense? Have I left anything out? Anything you want to dive in with?
Yes?
I'm wondering, is it about mostly classical music, or you think also a bit more like other directions also, like jazz and folk music, or some kind of contemporary music, electronic music?
Yeah, I wasn't able to do enough research with folk music and other types of music in Estonia. So I felt that if I just used this about one particular type of music, classical music, that you could take from it what you needed to make your own analysis of where your particular love in music is and how it's doing, if that makes sense.
Yes.
Yep. But thank you. So let's just take a look at our world. The world that we live in is truly, truly incredible. The last 70 years or more has been one of astonishing prosperity, despite what you might hear in the populist press and with populism in certain countries and from certain leaders. An extraordinary time of development. The world has never known a time of such riches, such development actually happening. We live in beautiful cities. We have fantastic healthcare. In fact, our life expectancy has changed altogether. Our life expectancy on a world basis to do with the developed world in the 19th century, about 1850, 1860, life expectancy was 36 years. Life expectancy in Manchester, in England, in 1840 was 26 years. Today, life expectancy is approaching 80 in the developed world. And if you are under the age of 25 at the moment, and some of you I see are, you stand a 50% chance now of making it to 100. Quite extraordinary. And by the year 2030, the average expectancy in South Korea, I don't know why South Korea, it must be all the kimchi that they eat, but the life expectancy in South Korea is 90. Then there's technology. And we have in our hands all the time one of these. I mean, we can't stop touching it. We need to have, yes, it's my fix. I'm addicted to this. I must have it. I must look at what the weather's doing. This is a priority. I must look to see what's happening in the news. I must look to see what my next WhatsApp is or my next email, whatever it might be. This has more firepower than the Starship Enterprise. You know the Starship Enterprise? Yep. No? Than science fiction. An astonishing device which we take totally for granted. So I'm going to stay with this theme of technology, because technology affects and guides and directs all our lives. It affects all our expectations and it affects our experience of the world. And that change, that addition that technology has made, has happened in a very, very brief period of time. And it particularly influences art and entertainment. I'll give you an example. For instance, you see people walking around listening to music on one of these or another device. Yeah, those people have headphones on or whatever it might be. All of that has nothing to do with quality. In fact, the sound that you get from one of these is compressed. Inevitably, it's compressed. So you're losing dynamic range. When I was a student, the only thing that anyone ever talked about was dynamic ranges and woofers and tweeters and bass sound and all of those things. That's gone out of the window completely. People want this because it's convenient and it's accessible. And that's how they are experiencing art and entertainment and music in particular. In 1991, there were worldwide 11 million of these. 1991, only 11 million. And it had two apps on it in 1991. They were, what do you think they were?
Phone calls and messages.
Phone calls and messages. They didn't have messaging at that time. It was phone calls, you're absolutely correct. It was phone and fax. Now, I would imagine that a number of people never heard of fax, no? Well, they had phone and fax, basta così. That was it. That was it. Today, there are 7 billion of these worldwide. And that number is just going to go whoosh, It'll just keep going. You all have been into Apple stores. The Apple iTunes store alone is a $36 billion enterprise. Just the iPhones. Just the iPhones. Media has been totally reinvented. It took television 38 years worldwide to reach 50 million people. 38 years to reach and to have as part of their network that number of people. It took Facebook 9 months to reach 50 million people. It is absolutely so different. The internet will provide the opportunity for all of us to communicate in one giant cultural network. It will be full of innovation, and is full of innovation, creativity, social change, and connectivity. And classical music has largely ignored all of it. It's not something that music has taken very seriously at all. And I'll give you a specific. Everyone here has used YouTube. Yes? You have to say something, otherwise I don't think you've heard me. Yes? Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Good. So everyone has tuned into YouTube. If you look at classical music on YouTube, it's really quite poor. Production values are poor, visibility is poor, marketing is poor, poor sound quality. People haven't really taken it very seriously at all. And yet it's the largest music platform in the entire solar system. The YouTube Symphony, did you ever come across the YouTube Symphony, which was created in 2011? Said it was an amazing success, that's what they were saying. And they managed to get 3 million views. 3 million views. Now that, in contrast to how classical music is normally seen on YouTube, certainly is a huge improvement. I think if people get 1,000 people, they will declare victory, or if they get 20,000, that would be extraordinary, or maybe 80,000, really, really amazing. People will say, this is what it's all about. But it's such a tiny, tiny, tiny drop in the musical ocean. Do you know how many views the most popular song on YouTube has received? Any guesses?
1 billion.
Hmm?
1 billion.
1 billion, did you say?
More.
1 billion. Okay, well, the bidding here starts at 1 billion. What?
More.
You think it's more? How many do you think? 2.5 billion. Wow. Anybody else? Yeah? I'm pointing back there. Go on. Yes?
Like 50 billion. 50 billion.
50?
Yeah.
There aren't that many people on the planet.
It's not about how many people are on the planet, right? Maybe I didn't get your question then.
Just how many views do you think the most popular song?
Yeah, but it is not about the people, but about
the number of views.
Yeah.
Yeah. 50 billion is perhaps a little bit
ambitious,
I'd suggest.
I'd say 400 million.
400 million? Million, 400 million. Okay. Well, the actual song is called Despacito, and it's received 5.6 billion views. 5.6 billion views. If you take a look at it, fantastic production values. A drama that they extend to you. Really wonderfully done. But 5.6 billion. Just somebody like David Bowie, for instance, if you look on his YouTube sites, it averages around 20 million. And that's just normal, you know, that's fine, about 20 million. We're missing out. We're missing out on technology. We're missing out on the visibility our art form deserves on the largest platform in the solar system for music. Other things have changed as well. I don't know if there are still CD stores in Estonia. Are there? Are there many? No. And I would suggest in the next year or two, there'll be even fewer. In New York City, there are no CD stores at all. That's completely finished. There are no vinyl stores. That has completely finished. People are looking to experience music differently through streaming. And then if we look at other forms of technology, we call this enhanced reality. This is an enhanced reality thing, machine. So that it gives you virtually all the knowledge that is contained in our world. This is the Library of Congress. This is the great bibliothecas in our inside pocket. Then there's virtual reality. Who has used a virtual reality headset? Yeah? Did you enjoy it?
Yeah.
Why?
Because I got to see a dinosaur.
Yeah? Well, how was your experience?
Oh, I didn't enjoy it that much. I think it's not yet developed so that one could really enjoy. I still enjoy all reality more.
Okay, I've never thought of it as being in competition to our reality. I've always thought of it as being something a little bit different.
I didn't like it. I felt weird.
You felt weird?
Yeah.
Okay. I'll give you my experience of it. I was working with a film school in North Carolina, and they've done some really fantastic work. And they said, you must come and experience our virtual reality headset. We're still designing it, but we think it's at a point now where it's really very exciting. So they took me and they put on the headset and they switched it on. And I was in the middle of a Syrian refugee camp. Everywhere I looked around, it was 360 experience. Everywhere I looked around, I was in this camp. I could feel this camp. I could sense it. I was there. I could hear them. And they said, this is a prototype at the moment. What we want to do is we want to make it 4D. We want you to be able to smell it. We want you to feel the heat. We want you to feel wind blowing through. We really want you to be immersed in that experience. And I was thinking, this is incredible. I wanted to take all those bloody politicians and put headsets on them and say, this is what it's like. This might be virtual reality, but this is close to reality as you're going to get. Actually looking and experiencing what these people are suffering from at the moment. And then I have lots and lots of thoughts about how that could impact the world of higher education as well, which I'll come on to in a little bit. And then there's this other thing that there's been a lot of discussion about, which is artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence essentially is about a computer learning itself, being able to problem solve and allowed to be creative. That's what artificial intelligence is all about. And I think it will develop in very, very interesting ways for us and should be seen as the handmaiden to our civilization rather than replacing the civilization, which are the threats that people tend to throw out there about artificial intelligence. So I said that music has ignored all of that. And I think the reason for that is that's supposed to be an out of solar system thing, okay? Not a great picture, but you'll get the idea. The reason for that is I think that music believes it lives in a parallel universe. And that there's therefore no need for us really to be looking at these things and taking them seriously or investigating them or applying them to the world of music. And I'll give you a specific on that. This is global music sales. This is recording sales. Can you see classical music? And have you found it? Right next to jazz, which is the same percentage. I became fascinated with this. This is my first example to you of data analytics. And you'll hear me say that word a lot, data analytics. Data analytics will tell you a huge amount about trends, music trends in the world, and will indicate where opportunities are, and also, it will also indicate where changes need to happen. I became fascinated with this as a result of working with, I won't mention their name, but I was working with a very, very well-known concert violinist who was recording Brahms concerto. And we got together, had a great time, the performances were fantastic, the recording was made, and then I sat down with her recording company. Her recording company was EMI. So this, you're not talking about a little diddly squat recording outfit, you're talking about a major, major label. And I said to the producer, can you just explain the financial sense of what you're doing and what your market is? And they said, well, what we're doing is we're making CDs. So I stopped him at that point. They said, you're making CDs? People still buy CDs? And they said, yes. I said, which people buy CDs? What are the demographics? Oh, people over the age of 65, sometimes over the age of 70. And how many do you sell? Enough to break even. What's break even? 6,000 or 7,000. So my next question to him was, how on earth is this sustainable? These people will be dead shortly. Where's your market then? And he said, I don't know. We haven't thought that one through yet. And I'm giving you that story, which is absolutely true. When you look at that 2% up there for classical music sales worldwide, it's very interesting what the sales are. They are selling black vinyls, because there's now some little interest in black vinyls, very little interest, and CDs. And they're not doing streaming. They're not taking streaming seriously. Streaming is the thing to get involved with. That's why you see all these wonderful, huge percentage segments here with other types of music. So all of a sudden, that change hasn't happened in people's thinking. And recordings are seen not necessarily as recordings anymore, they're seen as being the equivalent of a business card. Data analytics also indicate that the major growth area is with small ensembles in Europe and in America. And the reason for that is pretty various. Small ensembles are seen as being economic. There are no fixed costs involved with it. They're flexible, they're nimble, they're seen as being highly creative. They do new work, they present in a different way. They're sexy, they present themselves extremely well, and there's a big market for them. This is where a lot of creative energy is. This is a very interesting area, if you get involved with some data analytics, to actually see what is happening. Berlin, in particular, in Europe, is doing some astonishing work. So I got to know some of these ensembles, and I wanted to understand what their business model was and how they had trained themselves to do all of this incredible work. So I discussed things with Fifth House, Alarm or Sound, Red Note Ensemble, Eighth Blackbird, Berlin Ensemble. I did online rather than speak to anyone there. And one of the questions I asked was, you're very successful. What are the skills that you have needed to be as successful as you are? And this is not a definitive list, but these are some of the skills they talked about. Do you know what a click track is? You okay with click track? Shall I explain click track? Click track is when you're doing recordings, you as an instrumentalist, you would have cans on your ears, you'd have a headphone set on, and you'd have a click going, which is how you all stay together, basically. And if you've never worn one and you've never played with one, it's something you have to get used to, because it can be quite quite difficult. I then asked them a question, which was, how many of these skills did you learn in the conservatory system? And to a person, everyone said, none of them. We didn't learn any of these in at school at all. We had to learn them on the job. And I said, how difficult was that? It was pretty difficult and it was pretty challenging. Would it have been an advantage to have had these skills given to you when you were at the conservatoire? Absolutely, because this is about the contemporary world and the expectations of the contemporary world. I really felt, as I spoke to these people, that they were entrepreneurs. And this is my definition of entrepreneurship, which you can apply to music as well. All to do with discovering an opportunity, discovering a gap, discovering a problem, and then filling that with an idea, with tons of prototypes, whatever it might be, and then taking all of that and developing it into a vehicle that can be applicable to the real world. And then the skills that you need to be an entrepreneur. Got some virtual reality happening back there somewhere.
Yes.
I have got a bit to do with some business schools, and there are classes and courses all to do with how you train entrepreneurs, how you give them new skills. Scalable, is that something that is familiar to you? Do you know what a scalable project is? Scalable project means that it can develop, it can increase, it can become larger. Value proposition is really saying, this is what the project is, this is its vision, this is its mission for the future. Key performance indicators, which is a bit further down on that list, is how do you assess your success? What goals and targets have you set yourself so that you can actually monitor how you're doing as well? And the most important one at the end there is about the infrastructure you need to be successful as an entrepreneur learning at a school. And the infrastructure is huge. You need incubators. In other words, just like you hens and chickens go into incubators, so do creative people. They go into incubators in order to have that hot world feeling of their ideas generating and changing and becoming something which is more than they actually thought to begin with. And then accelerators, taking those ideas and accelerating them into the development stage. And then most of all, investors, people who believe in these projects and want to invest their money, their time and resources in making those things happen. And then if all of that comes together, you have this very famous word, which is startup. You begin a startup enterprise, be it musical or in business, whatever it might be. And sometimes those startups are successful, but not always. Very, very high failure rate as far as that's concerned, which is why everything else that has been taught and learned needs to affect everyone's thinking. So I'll pause for a moment there, because I've got I'm going to take you in a slightly different direction with the next slide. Any comments, any thoughts? I've got a list of who is here. So, Kelly? Who's Kelly? So, your thoughts, your comments. Already?
Yeah,
I've only been going for 35 minutes. Okay. Marcus, where I saw Marcus.
I'm here.
Yeah.
So I missed your last bit.
It was a question. I'm pausing here at this moment. So any reflections on what we've just been discussing?
Somehow I feel that I completely agree with this, that it's kind of the best time in the history of humanity that we're living now. But there's also downsides to the technological development. The automatization could potentially really destroy people's jobs in a large scale and kind of destroy the middle class, or really damage the position of bourgeois.
Yeah, but when you think about it, this is about the dangers and threats of technology taking people's jobs away. And it's very real, and it needs to be discussed and confronted in many ways. But when you think about technology over the last 500 years, for instance, combine harvester, for instance. So there were people saying, no, you're taking jobs away from people with scythes. Doing this all day, gathering the hay and all the rest of it, and all of a sudden it becomes mechanized. What happened to those people who, with the scythes? Well, some of them became machine operators, and other people retrained and went in very different directions. One of the things that had been said to me about technology, for instance, moving people out of their comfort zone in terms of their career expectations, their work expectations. If you take accountants, for instance, I don't know if you fill in your own taxes or you get an accountant to do it, but let's say you do employ an accountant. In the next few years, that won't be necessary. Everything can be done online, everything can be done for you. That level of accountancy will no longer exist. So that as a career path goes away and will be replaced by other paths. That is our history. Unless you're talking about total industrial change, unless you're thinking in those huge terms, one change will create another opportunity over here. I was reading an article about automated factories, and people say that's taken jobs away from people in automated factories and given them to machines. And the article was saying, well, it did do that, but it also created this whole new infrastructure of people who service the machines, who have to be expert in how those machines are put together, and they break down a lot, and they need redeveloping, and they need redesigning. So I think you're right to have that as a concern. I actually believe that we'll see other opportunities being created as a result. Okay, that was a nice pause. Yes?
Well, actually, I think the machines have to replace us, because nowadays we don't even have to use our brains, because we can check everything from the internet or our phones. We don't have to remember anything. So obviously, machinery is going to come and replace us, because we are going to be totally hopeless.
Well, it depends how we want to. depends how we want to use the machine. I think what we're doing is we're redefining knowledge. Knowledge has always been something where there's a sage, there's an expert, there's a professor. They have knowledge. They know absolutely everything. Knowledge was, probably still is to a certain extent, something that was internal to us. It was all up here. Knowledge for the future and now is external. You're walking around with the Library of Congress here. Library of Congress, all the bibliothecas in Europe, contained in this little machine here. You can't get all of that up here. This is a huge advantage. If I want to check something, or argue with my wife, or tell my son that he got that piece of information incorrect, I can check that. I can actually delve down and drill down as much as I want. That's not a bad thing to have here.
And it's also when you have to scroll all the time, you cannot actually concentrate on anything. I think this little thing, causes anxiety. I would really like to take a pause.
Yeah. Maybe we should. I work for a school in Boston these days, and also in Berkeley, Berkeley Valencia as well, and Berkeley College of Music. When their students start, their freshman students, their first-year students, they come in, they are all given laptop computers. They're given laptop computers. And they are expected to go to management courses on how you use that machine, because it's pretty involved after all. And they're given basic lessons on the laptop of how you make your first recording. And then what you do with that recording. I think where I'm trying to take the argument is there's more education that we should be doing about the advantages that these things can give us. At the moment, it's incredibly deregulated. And it's one of the things higher education should be taking on board, as well as elementary and secondary education as well. So let me, this is one of my favorite slides. Okay. This is a sort of pause slide, allow you to relax a bit. So who could answer the first question here? What's the difference between an audience member's experience of a concert and that of a musician? What do you think?
A musician
in an audience, absolutely.
In some way, mm-hmm. because his ear is like, you know, he's like covered with soap.
Covered with soap?
In some sense.
Mm-hmm. That's an interesting image. What do you think? Difference between a professional musician and an audience member? Sitting there, let's say I was here playing the Bach Chaconne, and you wouldn't want to hear me play the Bach Chaconne, I should add. And we have ordinary audience members, and we have the specialist string players who are there. What's the difference in their experience?
I'm not a musician myself. I wouldn't know what they experience on the stage.
So what do you experience?
But I, as an audience, I experience intrinsic values like aesthetical, being aesthetically raised, being, you know, get some kind of spiritual experience, whatever, all these kind of intrinsic experiences that I could get from the experience.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, there are different types of audience. Some audience get just the entertainment and free room, warm place to sit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's very true. What do you think?
I think that there's a difference when there are musicians audience,
mm-hmm.
because the experience is so different if you're a musician or if you're...
And what is it?
Maybe if you're a musician, you pay more attention to some technical aspects.
Ah, very good. You pay more attention to Sorry?
I mean, musicians are normally on stage performing, they're more picky, or like, okay, I did that wrong, and I did that wrong.
Yeah. The
person from the audience is mm-hmm. normally like, just come for enjoyment, just mm-hmm. to listen. And
you're very good. You've summed it up extremely well. I'll try and define it for you. This is as much as I know about neuroscience, which is that much, okay? So this is my neuroscience entire knowledge. You're going to get it in the next 30 seconds. An audience member, when they are listening, it's actually going to the pleasure part of the brain. It's going to that part of the brain which is to do with comfort and beauty and aesthetics. And it's a level of appreciation just above watching television, which is why when audiences get really comfortable, they fall asleep, and why audience members hardly ever notice a mistake. They just don't. Yep.
Unless you sit there as a
Putting those to one side. Yeah, that's a whole different animal. Musicians. So that's one part of the brain that they use. Musicians. The music is going into their heads, to the part of the brain to do with mathematics and language, very technical part of the brain. And what they're listening to and what experience they're having is to do with, oh, I don't like that fingering. Oh, no, I can play that slide. I wouldn't do that. And that fourth finger at that point. And why did they? And their phrasing, everything is very, very technical. It's not to do with pleasure necessarily at all. It's to do with the technical aspect of listening. And then this other question here, concert halls. So I think concert halls are a really bad idea, and I'll tell you why I think they're a bad idea. I was provoked once, years ago. I was in Amsterdam, and I was walking around Amsterdam with a Turkish friend. And we had a beer somewhere, and we walked past the Concertgebouw, one of the greatest concert halls in the world. So I pointed it out to him. And I said, this is the Concertgebouw. Fantastic acoustic, wonderful this, wonderful that. The greatest musicians have performed here. Mahler performed here. And he nodded like this. He said, yes, 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 yes. Yes, in Turkey, we feel very sorry for you in the West. I was shocked. He said, you put music in boxes for small numbers of people, whereas in Turkey, music is for everyone and is performed everywhere. And that's a fascinating argument. And I think it's fascinating because if you think about the boxes we put music in and the separation that we create between audiences and performers, and then all the barriers to entry that we create, all of those rituals, all of those, that mystique that surrounds the whole ethos of giving concerts and playing a concert prevents people from even wanting to experiment with it. Whereas if musicians just came out and performed anywhere, in whatever the setting might be, open air, coffee houses, a gymnasium somewhere, whatever it is, the connection, and I've done many projects like this, so I know what I'm talking about, and I've seen these experiences with audiences, and that the first reaction you get from your musician is, acoustics bad. To which I say, use amplification. To which they say, ooh, this is heresy. How dare you talk about music and amplification? And they tremble with perplexity and anger that I should even have mentioned this. And I say to them, have you checked out amplification these days? Have you seen how good it is? Have you any concept of what amplification can do to allow you the flexibility of performing anywhere you want in any community setting whatsoever? So, I think all concert halls should be burnt down and all musicians should go out and do amazing things in the community. Yes?
I work in the field of theatre, and I agree, all theatre is a big
thing. Oh, come on. Yay. Yep. You're a pianist, aren't
yes.
you?
Yes. And I'm Turkish.
And a Turkish pianist. Wow.
I agree to extend that, yes, you should maybe take things to the audience rather than waiting for mm-hmm. them to come to you.
Yeah. But,
unfortunately, we were brought up in such a way to believe that, if you like, certain concert halls and certain venues are the places that is a starting point for a musician. And I, for one, for your earlier experience, remember as a child, I was at the Beatles studying, and I used to go to the Billboard, seeing all my idols
yes.
sitting, and you know, what is she going to wear? Yeah. That was my idea. Mm-hmm. And then finally, actually coming in from backstage and facing the audience yourself, it is actually two different things. But
yeah.
you brought up to feel that that is the only place that
mm-hmm.
you can take a step to.
Mm-hmm.
And now I am at a stage in my career that I'm finding it hard to be an entrepreneur, to be a management, to be a good pianist,
mm-hmm.
trying to do everything at once,
mm-hmm.
but the pressure is so much, you know, you're wondering, should you be practicing, should
mm-hmm.
you be dealing with, you know, getting your next concert date. And when you do apply for somewhere, they are the ones, the men in black suits, or if you like, expect to know who you play with, where you perform. So if you say to them, I played in the coffee shop, they're not going to, you know, it's this pressure that we have. So how are you going to...
Well, maybe... Sorry.
I would actually say also that all these, I mean, rituals that as you call them, actually they can be attractive as well.
To whom?
People like me, for example. I am very, I don't know, I can only speak for myself, but I think it's a fantastic experience to get dressed and actually go to the concert hall or the opera hall and sit there for 2-3 hours without any rituals happening there. And on the other side, if you say that the musicians should start walking about in the cafes or wherever, I mean, in the subway or something. Mm-hmm. Isn't this kind of the same thing as the, you know, the pop-up ads?
The which?
Pop-up ads.
Yeah.
You want to read an article, hey, there's an ad. And then you go to a coffee shop, damn it, there's a musician.
It may be unfair on the musician.
I think that both solutions are very important. To reach out to the new audiences, you have to go out and make an offer on the beach. Go for it.
Yes.
But at the same time, we should still value the institutional value of high arts with all its rituals, with all its venues. We should keep the system as it is running because it has its own values as well. As I said, some people value this, and some other people value the opera singer and the coffee shop. That's okay, and we should train our musicians to be able to cover all this versatility.
Yes.
It's not like this or that, it's both.
Yeah. So I'm provoking you. This is good. Yeah?
Me?
Nope. Let's forward.
Yes, so this is very, very clear as provocative. Yeah. Actually, I agree with you. I think the good musicians and also the best of all orchestra players, they do this thing. They do both. They go to concerts, they go to schools, they go to community houses, but they also have this incredible acoustics and also for. And I would say, I think the Berlin Philharmonic wouldn't be what they are without this incredible hall.
But I worked with the Berlin Philharmonic, and what impressed me enormously about that orchestra, getting to know some of the players, was that they saw their role in their community as being much, much, much bigger than playing in the Philharmonic. And they went out, this was something that Simon Rattle encouraged, they went out and they worked with immigrants. They worked with the Turkish population there. And it wasn't, you know, I'm going to play now, or this is an oboe and this is what a reed does. It wasn't that. It was really interactive, deep musical relationships that they created, experimenting with other types of music, getting them actively involved in music making, and then bringing them into the lobby of the Philharmonie, and then eventually to come and see the orchestra, and being greeted by all of the musicians as really important members of their society. And I think that orchestra is very, very unusual, unfortunately. Well, fortunately, they are who they are, but unfortunately, other people are not replicating what they are doing and the experiences that they have.
But I thought you have it much more in Great Britain, because actually in Germany it was the first time that Simon Rattle brought it like this. So they just made very high musicians go just down to schools. And so it is very new, and this education program is incredible what they do.
Yeah.
Every single musician is a great teacher.
Yeah, I absolutely. Support what you're saying. They are. That could be a longer conversation. Let me take you on. Career skills. A lot of conservatoires, or some conservatoires, offer career skills, which they often call entrepreneurship. And career skills are really the basics of the skills you need when you go out there in the wider world. I think that they get confused with something which is bigger and more developed, which is entrepreneurship. So there are all the things that we know about career skills. And these should be so basic, and they should be taught to every single student and on a default system, and it should be a no-brainer. This is who they are, what they need, and these are the skills to actually help them when they go out into the wider world. Unfortunately, the number of conservatoires that, actually promote that type of idea in Europe is not at 100% by any means, and that's a wasted opportunity. So I'm getting to the nervous part of my presentation here, because I want to actually give you a couple of examples of innovation and performance, which means that technology has got to perform for us, which is why I'm very grateful to have my colleague at the back here who has helped me with this one. You're on. I'm about to do this one and I'm nervous, okay? So I'm going to play you something. It's from the BBC Proms. So you can't get better than the BBC, can you? I mean, it's a mark of quality and all the rest of it. But I want to see how you respond to it. This is the Berliner Ensemble. Like it? Horrible? Nasty? Never want to hear it again? What are your thoughts? You've just experienced some really great music making. You must have some thoughts about it.
I prefer Frank Sinatra.
But I also like other versions of those hits as well.
Yeah, I prefer covers.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. I like something more contemporary. I like when usual stuff put together something what's not doing every day and merge them and perform them. But it has to be really well calculated as well.
Yeah, that was pretty, well calculated.
Yeah, it was.
Yep.
I love this song, so I'm like crying now.
Yeah,
it was amazing.
I liked it, like the way she was singing, her bass voice, and she was connecting to the audience. Like, I could not understand. I'm an Indian, so but something emotional was there that I could understand and feel it.
Yes,
it was nice.
Yeah. When I first saw that, I was really knocked out by it, because for me it sort of defines a performance, however you look at performance, in whatever genre you might be thinking about. It defines it because, first of all, it's at the highest level, it's fantastic quality, the arrangement is astonishing, and there's a genuine connection between the performer and the audience. You can feel it, you can sense it, it's palpable. You watch the people behind her when they're performing, and they're enjoying it. I've worked with orchestras in America where musicians have been taken to one side, and I'm not exaggerating here, to one side by the orchestra committee, their own members, their own musician colleagues, to say, you're reacting to the music. We don't do that. You just play. You just play. Which deprives the audience of engagement. It deprives them of a whole other level of engagement. See what you think of this one. I'm at the proms again. And what do you think about playing by heart?
It's difficult. The whole concert, all the symphony by heart.
Yep. They all learnt it by heart. And look at the communication that happens between the musicians. You don't have that stand in front of you, which is like a huge obstacle anyway. You don't have that stand in front of you. You're actually playing with your colleagues, enjoying playing with your colleagues, and you're communicating and engaging with your audience as well. Other thoughts on this?
But I'm not used with it. I'm not used to listen and to hear it this way.
Do you like it?
I don't know.
So you'd like to listen to it again?
Yes, maybe I would like to listen and see it more, and then I can have an opinion.
It would be definitely interesting to experience it in live, I guess. Mm-hmm. In live concert. But it is very cool. Mm-hmm. Some kind of barrier between classical musicians and audience has been removed, and by that music is more closer and more open to get into as audience also, which is interesting. But in other genres of music, this kind of thing is very natural and
yes,
like normal.
Yeah. And we have a theatre person here. I saw Amadeus in London recently, and it was done with this orchestra, and they acted. They went in the pit playing bits and pieces. They were acting with all of these other wonderful artists on stage. And you could see the joy it gave, not just the audience, but the musicians themselves. They were being extended. See what you make of this one. This is... this is the University of Maryland Symphony Orchestra. This is an orchestra of young musicians, of students. Do you know the piece? It's Aaron Copland's Appalachian Springs. The work done all the time in America for obvious reasons. Any thoughts on that? What did you think of it?
I think it was beautiful.
Yeah.
Now and then I go to like a traditional culture setting, mm-hmm. and I do get things out of it, but it's not my favorite thing. It can be pleasant, but like this, I think I absolutely love it because it's more of like this holistic experience.
Mm-hmm. Other thoughts?
There is something really, really bourgeois about that kind of the traditional setting of, mm-hmm. of the orchestra.
Yeah.
I think this is transcending that.
Yes.
In a very strong
way. Yeah. I agree with you.
Putting them together, you know, musicians and actors. And,
mm-hmm.
I feel bad for people in the orchestra pit. I was.
Yeah.
You're doing something, but all the people up there are seeing.
But you know what? The orchestra is one of the main protagonists,
yes.
One of the main antagonists. Was I was saying about Amadeus,
mm-hmm.
and tons of Mozart was played, bits of the operas, bits of concertos, bits of the symphonies, and the musicians were there. They weren't in a pit, they were there.
Well, combined with the performance element, for me, it gave me a cinematographic experience. I immediately remember the old silent films where you had music accompanying what's going on the stage or whatever scene.
Yeah. And there's nothing wrong with that. I'm going to move us on. You'll know him, yeah? In 2006, you don't?
Nope.
We're not this family.
Ah, well, there's the Yevi family. Nemi Yevi, Christian Yevi, Pavel Yevi, yes? Father, two sons, great, great conductors. This guy, in 2016, I was in here, and I was invited to a concert. And I thought, well, who's conducting? And I was told who was conducting. I thought, oh, that could be interesting. And he was bringing a brand new orchestra that he had created of very young people to the stage here, to the concert hall. And I have to say, it was an absolutely fantastic concert. It was a little bit like we have been experiencing, let's say, with the Berliner Ensemble. People were really communicating. They were really engaged. And at the end of the concert, Christian dives off the stage. He allows the orchestra to play its own encores. And he takes people from the audience and starts dancing with them around like this. And it was tremendous. I thought, yeah. We need more of this. And then the next day, it was part of a conference. The next day, I heard the criticisms. How dare he do that? This is compromising the worth and the beauty of music. Music speaks of itself.
Destroying the pure art.
Yes, it's so pure, it's still a virgin. And that's the way people wanted to leave it. Yep.
Do you know what we're talking about?
No filters. You know what? You need lots of people with different characteristics in order to have a really interesting life and an interesting world. No filters works for me. Anyway, I was interested that people were still so conservative in terms of how they wanted their music to be presented to them. I want to bring some of the things that we have been discussing. I want to bring it around to some new programs that I have been experiencing. The first, and I've seen this in several universities, like Thornton School, University of Southern California, Berklee College of Music in Boston and in Valencia, Royal Northern College of Music in Manchester, ArtEZ in Holland, and there are a couple of others that won't immediately come to my mind. But the first one I wanted to bring to your attention is film scoring and video games. And if you say film scoring in a conservatory setting, film scoring, that is writing music for movies and what have you, it's just below being a sex worker. People get, oh, so commercial. No. And people look down. My life in Boston, I remember once putting a film composer up to get a major award, and it was, really? Really? Is that what it's about? Because they're consigned somewhere. that is totally inappropriate, I believe, to their talent and what the great film composers have actually contributed to our world and to our lives. Now, I'll mention some of them to you. Eric Korngold, Max Steiner, Morricone. Do you know Morricone? Yeah? Did you see Tarantino's Hateful Eight, which is the most recent Tarantino movie? Just check it out. I don't think it's a great movie, but my God, it's good. It's good music. Astonishing what he's doing. And the man's 80 something. Danny Elfman and Tim Burton, Thomas Newman, Elmer Bernstein, Philip Glass. Do you watch Game of Thrones? Anybody watch Game of Thrones? You haven't lived if you're not watching Game of Thrones.
Yeah, I'm watching Game of Thrones.
Yeah? Good. Hans Zimmer. You mentioned Hans Zimmer to certain people, they spit at you. I think the music he wrote for the Batman movies, and in particular the one he did for Dunkirk a couple of years ago, astonishing.
Interstellar, I think that's the best.
And Interstellar, absolutely. These are composers, and I haven't even mentioned the most famous composer of all time. And that's Beethoven and Bruce Willis and the use of the Ninth Symphony in the Die Hard movies. Of course, one should be mentioning one or two other people who wrote Star Wars and all of that stuff, but I'll leave that for another time. Video games. Have you listened to video games music?
Yeah.
You must have played video games, yeah?
It can be terrible.
Sorry?
It can be terrible.
I think it was terrible. I don't think it's terrible anymore. I think there are some astonishing young composers who are writing large symphonic scores for video games. And a lot of people are putting those scores into major concerts with symphony orchestras. And I think it's really, really astonishing. There's one that I love called Skyrim. First of all, the graphics are astonishing, but you obviously play it, yes? No? Check it out, Skyrim. And the score, this 90-piece symphony orchestra is playing at you and making itself part of the drama. Pop music. Again, you tend to get spat at if you say pop music in a conservatory setting. What I have seen, I'll take USC, Thornton School, University of Southern California. 1,000 music students, 500 are in the classical department, 500 are in the pop department. Nice interplay between the two. And the pop, the young pop artists who are doing film scoring, video games, music production, songwriting, are learning a lot from the classical people, and the classical people are learning a lot from them. I saw that absolutely at the Royal Northern College of Music in Manchester, where the classical people were saying, I want to be part of their orchestra. It's really exciting, it's really contemporary, and we want to help with the arrangements. So we're starting to see, I think, a new blend, a new type of thinking about contemporary music. And by contemporary music, I mean the music that we have in our everyday lives, all the time, everywhere. And it'll be fascinating to see where this is going to take us for the future. You do online learning here? No? Do you know about online learning? Online learning is it's a very, very big thing. And just apply what I'm about to tell you to what we were discussing earlier about technology. Put those two things together. You've got dynamite. You've really got dynamite. So in 2011, 2012, Harvard, MIT in Boston, Massachusetts Institute for Technology, one of the biggest universities in the world, one of the most successful universities in the world, together with Microsoft, I forgot Microsoft, together with Microsoft, decided to create something called MOOC. You've not come across this word. Massive Open Online Curriculum. Massive Open Online Curriculum, which they wanted to be accessible to everyone. And a lot of people in the developing world, a lot of people in China, a lot of people in India, took advantage of this. It's mostly free. It's mostly free. And the first time that they launched into this, they had 1.5 million people sign up. And then that attitude started, which was, well, you know, there'll be a lot of dropouts. That, you know, it just won't work for these people because they're not part of the education thing after all. And it's not that good. It's not at the highest quality. Well, the first year you learn a great deal. 1.5 million people became 800,000 people. How many universities would you have to build to accommodate 800,000 new students? How many universities? Now, and I find this to be really breathtaking, check this one out, the Khan Academy, K-A-H-N, which I've actually signed up for that one because I'm terrible at mathematics, and they have a go-at-your-own-speed mathematics class. And he's made it available to everyone, from universities through to people in middle school. Coursera. Have you come across Coursera? Coursera has 5 million. They don't call them students. They call them learners. 5 million. And this is opening up the whole of higher education. Now, if standards in terms of presentation and what have you are not as high as they could be, that's not surprising. But when you think about over here the developments in technology and how technology can be aligned with this and start to take this type of experience to a completely different area, completely new level of learning. Think about virtual reality and online learning. Think about artificial intelligence and online learning, where this could take us. I think I've done technology to death here, haven't I? And then data analytics. A lot of schools are deeply involved with data analytics. They want to understand what is happening in their industry. And we tend not to do that in classical music. We tend not to say, well, where are the trends? Who is doing well? Who's not doing well? Maybe I heard something, but where's the data to support some of the changes that need to happen? Because data analytics will tell you how you're performing and will tell you about changes that you need to make, particularly to the curriculum. And if you're not monitoring your curriculum all the time to see whether it's relevant to what students need to have, you're really training students for jobs that don't exist anymore. And that's not a good use of anyone's resources. You take a look at current teaching trends in conservatories. And this is true everywhere across the world. Music, I think, is the only discipline I'm aware of that still maintains an 11th century model, 1,000 years after it was invented, which is you have a master and you have an apprentice. And you work with that master as an apprentice, and that master is the single most important reason why you have selected to come to the conservatory of your choice. You're there because the conservatory had the wisdom to employ this person, and you want to have part of that magic in your lives. Is there another way of doing it? I'm not saying you dispense with it altogether. I'm just saying, is that it? Because whenever I mention it, people say, oh, you can't change that. That's sacrosanct. I mean, it's worse than heresy if you think of doing that. Well, I've seen different ways of doing it. I've seen teachers take a back seat and facilitate, and very, very, very subtly, facilitate having, let's say it's a piano lesson, having three or four of his or her students actually take the lesson and allowing it to be a peer learning experience rather than the master apprentice. I have seen, rather than the studio model, the seminary model, I have seen violinists, for instance, be scheduled with a percussionist, because in fact what they're playing lacks is really great rhythm. I've seen pianists who's playing lax cantabile being associated with singers. I've seen something called the flipped classroom. You ever come across this one? Flipped classroom? Flipped classroom, it's basically it's redefining the whole notion of teaching and learning. And instead of the teacher being, in America they call it the sage on the stage. So instead of being the sage on the stage, the teacher is the facilitator. The teacher produces the materials that the students have to take a look at, but the students are in charge of the class. It makes the whole concept of learning far more responsible. In other words, it switches the relationship so that the relationship is more dominant to the student. These are fascinating things to take a look at and fascinating things to experiment with. The conservatory world, it loves saying these words, but it's not very good at them. You often see the word innovation, but we're not very innovatory. And if you're going to be innovatory, you need to take risks. And if you're innovatory and you take risks, then you've got creative solutions. And that, all of that takes a lot of courage. So instead, we have the culture of the conservatoire. And the culture of the conservatoire is incredibly strong. It is a culture which is steeped in a wonderful history and an astonishing repertoire, which many of us would argue is some of the greatest works of art ever produced by mankind. And I'm not arguing with any of that. But it's also steeped in myths and legends. It's also steeped in some real problems, because we can't get out of our own way. So here are two of the major problems as I see them. We're so steeped in the tradition that we're saying, well, we can't change. So inertia means you don't go forward. Inertia means you're there. And then, have you ever come across the word Gordian knot? I won't give you.
The one with the sword?
No, Gordian knot was to do with Alexander the Great, who sorted out actually this terrible knot. So this knot that no one could ever undo, he just took his sword out and swiped it anyway. So you've got historic curricula here with tons and tons of territory invested in tons and tons of history and people. And I've looked at the curricula of so many institutions, and you get this central band which makes a great deal of sense. And then over the years, and it's very understandable that it happens, over the years you get what I call these growths happen, and then the growths become bigger and bigger. And then nobody can change it, because there are all these growths that are owned by people, and it would be seen as revolution if you changed it. But if you did your data analytics, the data analytics would tell you these are the most important things. And I don't think we're saying what is the most important thing. And this is an example for me of something which is strange when you think about it. Symphony orchestras. Symphony orchestras, that's the large ensemble program in virtually every single conservatoire. And it takes up the most resources, the most money. It demands facilities. It demands a big budget. And it also informs who you should be recruiting for students, because you need four bassoons that year, or you're short on violas. It will affect all of your plans as well. And the other thing that it does, it's not creative. It's not creative remotely, orchestras, because your individual creativity is subsumed by this large ego on the stage. And there's only one creator, and that creator is the conductor. So it seems strange, given that symphony orchestras are not doing that well, given that their market is reducing, given that the number of job opportunities with orchestras is also reducing significantly, this still is the magnet for resources and planning. So I took a look at Estonia, at all the orchestras you have here. If I've left anything out, please shout. I got this from the government and from Kai. Those are the orchestras. These are the opera companies. And these are the employment figures in Estonia. Now, there's not going to be a lot of change every year. Once you're in an orchestra, you tend to want to stay in that because it's regular work, and it's going to help you pay the mortgage and all of those good things. So 50% of each orchestra doesn't change every year. 20% of an orchestra doesn't change every year. Maybe you get one or two. And the competition to fill those places is really extraordinary. When I ran the Minnesota Orchestra in the States, we had one vacancy at the back of the cello section. We had nearly 200 applications from around the world. And each of those applicants who was eventually invited to come and audition, everyone had to pay their own way to come and play for us. We weren't covering anything. And they were willing to make that investment because of the chance, the possibility that that one position might fall to them. This is a figure on the number of professional musicians working in Estonia. Your academy has done very well. You have 98% of all graduates are working in the field of music or the creative industries. I think that's very, very strong.
I'd be a bit suspicious of this number, but still.
I was quoting what I was given.
Yeah,
okay.
It's based on feedback which is done 6 months after graduating. So might be not the truth.
Okay. I didn't feel that it was up to me to say that.
Yeah.
But there's also this one that's in it, that's as a quote here, which is young musicians are looking at freelance careers. And if you're looking at a freelance career, if you're looking at doing things differently and creating your own opportunities, what are the skills you need to actually be able to do that successfully? Audiences in this country are also really quite extraordinary. You've got a population base of 1.3 million. And you've got 2 million concert goers. You also have a younger demographic for concert goers than you would find traditionally in most places. But the question for me is, how sustainable is the life of a musician? And what are musicians paid? And how many jobs does a musician need to have in order to make ends meet? And then, the relationship with students. How do students see all of these things? What is the student voice? How do you see technology? How do you see your skills? How do you see the opportunities for work later on? How are you driving the discussion? How are you driving the debate? What are your contributions to all of the things that we have been touching upon this afternoon? So I think that's really important. And then where are the work opportunities? Well, you do your data analytics and you would discover where the work opportunities are. But the European Union, there are currently 28 countries you can work in, surely to be 27, because of the lunacy and stupidity of Great Britain. You've got 27 other countries, and some of those are really interesting to take a look at. Very, very interesting, because they have been thinking about things a bit differently. And the resources are there to help sustain careers as well. So we're virtually at the end here. So my conclusions at the end of all of this is, I answer my own question. What do we need to change? Need to change a lot. We need to be more aware of the contemporary world. We need to find our place in the contemporary world, and I believe that that place will be a very, very important one if we can define the terms of engagement, if we can look at the advantages of technology rather than thinking of technology as a threat, if we can look at new ideas such as online learning or the connection with the pop industry or the connection with film. And we can think about those things in a holistic way and think about them as creating a new definition, a new way of taking a look at who we are as musicians, rather than having a very narrow trench, a very narrow deep trench, which we feel is the only direction forward that we could possibly have. And then if all of that is too much, we should just do our assignments. So if this has been helpful to you, I hope that it has, not in the sense of coming to any conclusions, but in the sense of provoking a discussion, provoking a debate about who we are, what we are doing, and what we should be doing for the future and our relationship with the contemporary world, then it's been worthwhile. If I've annoyed you, and I know I annoy a lot of people, that's okay too. And if you want to continue a discussion with me, please take a photograph of that, and I'm very happy to hear from you. Just put Estonia on it, and I'll know where we met. Thanks very much.